If you put every cyber criminal in the world in one country today, that country would have the third largest gross domestic product on the planet. It would be the third largest economy in the world, $11 trillion in cyber criminal revenue last year.
Wow.
This is, so think of like the traditional organized crime rings that we've had in the world for, you know, time immemorial. Now those traditional organized crime rings, and I am told there are in fact the five families of cybercrime, they are operating at scale, and they are frankly very, very successful. I think it's hard to say that the good guys are winning when you look at the outcomes for last year.
Oh, interesting. And how does, it's the inevitable question, but how does the entrance of AI into this overall picture, I would almost say like the, what, the democratization of cybercrime might be a way of thinking about
so
it?
So I love that. Yeah. So I think it's two things. We've certainly seen, I mean, with the proliferation of artificial intelligence combined with the unfortunate democratization of lots of very advanced cyber capabilities, so things that would previously have been the domain of nation states, we're now seeing in the public domain. So potent cyber capabilities combined with AI, I would put it this way. It's been a lowering of the barrier to entry to being a quite sophisticated cyber actor. So you think about my like smelly boys from back at the NSA days. What did you need to be a hacker 10 years ago? Well, you needed an advanced degree in computer science, or you needed to be a savant from the dirt farms of Mississippi. You needed to be identified as someone special in this space. You needed this advanced degree. You needed 18 months of highly classified training. You needed access to a nation state toolkit. You needed covert infrastructure. This was not an individual sport 10 years ago. Now what do you need? Kids today who want to be professional hackers, a little bit of ChatGPT, watch some YouTube videos the same way our kids learn how to do anything, and then they're off to the races as quite sophisticated cyber actors. So it's that lowering of barrier to entry, but it's also, I would put it as a scalability increase. So an ability to increase the scope and scale and velocity of cyber attacks to a level that I wouldn't have been able to imagine, you know, 5 years ago. So can I give you an example of one of these like AI-enabled cyber attacks that we see? This is one where the attack itself is as old as time, but AI has proved to be this catalyst, making the attack way more potent than I first saw it years ago. So this is sort of your classic credential validation attack. Every CIO has experienced these and is experiencing them today, whether they know it or not. This is where a hacker goes out to the dark web and buys 10 million credential pairs, so logins and passwords. So every company that gets breached, where the hacker goes after all the logins and passwords, dumps them for sale on the dark web, all of these new hackers will buy that list of 10 million credential pairs from AT&T, knowing that people are lazy and weak, and that we all use the same password again and again and again. And so maybe the password you were using for your mobile is the same one you're using for your bank account. So the hacker is going to take those 10 million logins and passwords and is going to try to throw them against my authentication gateway just to see what sticks, right? Are any of my clients using the same password in multiple places? Now, 10 years ago, you could run that attack, but you would be fat fingering in those logins and passwords into my front door, my authentication gateway, for the rest of your life. Now what do you do? ChatGPT gens up that Python script for you, runs through all of those compromised logins and passwords, autofills my, you know, password field again and again and again, and plays cat and mouse with me on the back end. So how would we have detected one of these attacks in the past? Well, even with a script, I would have said, human beings don't type that fast. This is a bot. This isn't real. Well, so what does AI do? Slows down that pace of typing to look exactly like what I would expect a normal American in Peoria, what their typing speed to look like. So every control I put in place, the fact that you've got AI leveraging the attacks against me, everything I do, every remediation, every control, every dodge, every pivot is a data point for the AI on the other side saying, oh, I've learned something about my defenses, about my approach, and I'm going to get a little bit better tomorrow in how I go about this. Now, to increase the scale, they are leveraging botnets that are now available for rent on the dark web. So obviously nation states have been using botnets, you know, think highly hackable endpoint devices, Internet of Things type devices all over the world. If I can generate a script that harvests the computing power of 10,000 smart TVs, now all of a sudden I have a distributed covert infrastructure all over the world in the form of smart televisions to help me launch this attack. One of the recent attacks we saw, we were under attack by a herd of smart refrigerators. 10,000 refrigerators throwing 10 million credential pairs against my front door. Now, again, the botnet, it's not terribly smart. All it returns to the hacker is a thumbs up, thumbs down. This login and password does or does not work for a customer of this bank. But it's what happens next, right? If we get that thumbs up, the hacker is going to try to log into those accounts, set up bill payments, money movements, all the kinds of things you would have seen a traditional fraudster do 10 years ago. But now with AI, all of that is happening lightning speed, completely scaled and automated. The volume and the velocity, really, really intense.